of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit is now in session.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us for our virtual argument. This morning we're going to hear argument in two cases. We've submitted three cases, Metaskian versus Garland, which is case number 20-71573, Campos Bergueno versus Garland, which is number 17-71672, and Daw versus the Office of Navajo and Hopi Indian Relocation, which is case number 20-17261. Our first case for argument this morning is going to be Johnson versus Baker. Before we begin, I'll just quickly introduce the panel. I'm Bridget Beatty. I'm a circuit judge with my chambers in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm very pleased today to be sitting with my colleague, Circuit Judge Patrick Bumate, whose chambers are in San Diego, California. And Judge Bumate and I are both very grateful and pleased to be sitting today with Judge Berman, who's a district judge in the Southern District of New York, his chambers in New York City. So we have, Mr. Williams and Mr. Zunino arguing Johnson versus Baker. And we have 15 minutes per side. Mr. Zunino, there you are. Okay. If you'd like to proceed, please go ahead.
Good morning, Judge Beatty, Judge Bumate, Judge Berman. My name is Greg Zunino, and I'm representing the Nevada Department of Corrections through Renee Baker, who appeals in her official capacity as a warden with the Nevada Department of Corrections. I would like to, if I may, reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay, please keep an eye on the clock.
And I would like to begin, if I may, with a hypothetical. And I think this hypothetical demonstrates what I believe is an important distinction in this case between the quantitative and the qualitative. And that was something that the district court judge in this particular instance did not grapple with or address in any detail. So assume that my religion teaches me to emulate the ways of the deity whom I worship, to emulate the ways and the life and the habits and the practices of that deity. And my deity, when he was here on earth, before he ascended to the heavens, endured a tremendous amount of suffering, and he made enormous sacrifices for the good of humanity before he ascended to the heavens. And one of the part of the suffering that he endured was on his last day on earth, before he ascended to the heavens, he was forced to march along a path through an ancient city, an ancient holy city, and that path was approximately 600 meters long, and he had to carry a very heavy weight on his back. And my spiritual needs require that I reenact this march along this ancient path. We call it the Via Dolorosa, and so. I've requested the prison officials let me walk this 600 meter linear path with a very heavy backpack on my back to simulate my deity's last day on earth. But I'd like to perform that once a week before the Sabbath. The prison officials in this case have told me that I can't do that. I can't walk a linear path 600 meters because the exercise yard is not big enough for me to do that. And so I can walk maybe 70 or 80 meters with this very heavy 100-pound backpack on my back, but that has no religious significance to me, and it has no religious significance to me to pace back and forth within the yard. I believe that my spiritual needs require me to walk this full 600 meter distance at least once a week. And I've requested an accommodation and I would perhaps even be willing to do this once annually as opposed to once a week. But I think it would require my supervised release from the four walls of the prison, and the prison officials in this case are unwilling to accommodate that. So I use this hypothetical to demonstrate what I indicated is a distinction between the quantitative and the qualitative. And my hypothetical has two quantitative elements to it. There's there's this question of the linear path that I would like to walk, and that should be 600 meters, and the prison officials are not willing to accommodate that. And then additionally, there's this question of how frequently I can do this during the course of the year, and I would like to do this once a week. Perhaps the prison officials would let me do this once a year. I don't know. I doubt that's the case. But this is similar to the kind of quantitative issue that was at issue in Mr. Johnson's case. So Mr. Johnson,
okay, counsel, wouldn't the more accurate analogy be, though, if that hypothetical existed, but you let other prisoners walk 700 meters every day? Because in this case, the prison allows 14 ounces bottles of unscented baby oils, Irish Spring soap, Tide laundry detergent, Bounce, dry sheets. So isn't that really what the situation is, where you let seemingly similar activity occur, but not this religious activity?
Well, it depends on how you frame the issue, right? Question is substantial burden, then you don't reach the question of you know, compelling governmental interest or restrictive means. So in this case, the judge simply concluded without any factual findings that there was a complete denial of Mr. Johnson's ability to perform his religious practice in this case.
How is that not accurate? He's denied his ability to perform the scented oil prayer 34 out of 35 times a month.
Well, that's a quantitative distinction. I'm not sure that it's a qualitative distinction. It may be, or there may be some middle ground there. For example,
regardless of how you classify it as qualitative or quantitative, it is a substantial burden.
Well,
how is it not?
There's one line of cases in the Ninth Circuit that tells us that a substantial burden is one that forces an inmate to forego or abandon a religious precept or a religious tenet. Yeah.
So we can see that violates that line of cases.
Well, no, what I think here is that we have to define the precept of the tenet that we're talking about. And according to Mr. Johnson's testimony, the precept was, you know, I want to emulate the ways of the Prophet Muhammad. You know, he didn't point to any textual support or any oral history for that matter that suggests that the Prophet Muhammad used scented oil in every single prayer. I mean that's nowhere found in the record.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but at this stage of the case, I don't think we question whether or not that's a sincerely held belief, or if that's a truly held belief, right? I thought we assumed that that's a truly held belief.
Well, I'm not questioning whether it's sincere. I'm questioning whether that's an actual precept.
Right. I thought we, at this stage, don't we assume that to be the case?
Well, I think that if we take the inmate at his or her word that anything that he chooses to do has spiritual significance without testing that, reference to some textual support, some oral history, something. Then I mean, we're on a very slippery slope, right? And I think we lead kind of to the slippery slope that I explored with my hypothetical, which is, well, at some point, do I need to be released from the four walls of the prison in order to reenact this march along the Via Dolorosa that has religious significance to me, certainly. Just as Mr. Johnson's use of scented prayer oil has religious significance to him, but I don't know necessarily that giving him the opportunity to use scented oil once a week as opposed to five times daily, it is necessarily a substantial burden. Like I said, at some point, a quantitative difference probably becomes a qualitative burden, right? So, but I think there's some middle ground here in terms of, and if we consider the regulation itself that was under scrutiny here, the regulation did not actually put any limitation or restriction upon the quantity. It just requires that the oil be used within the chapel, within the confines of the chapel, and then it be under the custody and control of prison officials. The regulation itself, which is 810.2, deals just strictly with this question of who possesses the oil, just who possesses the oil, who has custody of it, right? So it was actually the prison's procedural practice related to the opening and the closure of the chapel that creates the burden, assuming there's a burden. It's not actually the regulation itself. And that was one issue.
Doesn't the regulation forbid him from possessing the oils in his cell?
It does, but it...
So isn't that the issue?
It does not prevent him from... Technically, it does not prevent him from using the oil 5 times daily or 3 times daily or once daily or whatever it may be, right? It's the operational practice that forbids that. So I think when this case began, arguably, the complaint could have been construed to assert both a facial challenge and an as-applied challenge. The amendment to the regulation mooted the facial challenge. I don't think that the regulation itself is neutral. It's not, it imposes no burden on use of scented oil, right? It's the operational practice. And I think the judge kind of at trial, by failing to deal with the mootness question as a discrete kind of legal issue, in fact, a jurisdictional issue, she conflated the facial challenge and the as-applied challenge. And ultimately then kind of gave the inmate in this case fashioned a remedy that effectively struck down the regulation as if it were facially invalid, which it was not. I mean, the remedy that she crafted was you shall be allowed to use oil in your cell. And the regulation says you shall be allowed to use oil in the chapel. And so I think that was an inappropriate remedy that the judge fashioned in this case. And ultimately, I think had she dealt with the mootness question as a discrete legal issue, the parties would have had some opportunity to explore kind of some middle ground, in terms of how frequently are we going to have to open the chapel to satisfy you? I mean, at some point, it seems like the prison officials should be able to accommodate Mr. Johnson without actually letting him possess oil in his cell.
Counsel, do you have any concerns about the breadth of the injunctive relief? One of the issues in the record that I found a bit confusing was where Mr. Johnson was housed. It appeared he moved to different places, and when he testified at trial, he was speaking in the present tense, so it suggested he was talking about the facility where he was housed at that time. You have presented testimony below suggesting that each of these facilities has different operational concerns. And so my concern with the injunction was, should it have been tailored in any way to deal with any particular facility?
Well, I think it should. And part of the problem with the trial was that the ground rules weren't very clear, right? And I don't blame that on anyone in particular. And Mr. Johnson raised literally dozens and dozens of claims that the judge and the parties had to plow through before they could winnow the issues down and deal strictly with this injunction. But you're right. I mean, every prison is different. The regulation has general applicability to all the prisons. In other words, anyone can use scented oil in the chapel if the scented oil is in the possession of prison officials, right? But prisons differ from place to place. And Mr. Johnson, kind of through counsel, introduced this idea that, well, baby oil is rampant and laundry detergent and bounds fabrics.
Is there any prison in Nevada that allows prisoners access to the chaplain 5 times a day?
I don't know, Your Honor. That could certainly be addressed going forward. I mean, if that's a necessary accommodation, then I would think that the prison officials should be afforded the option to consider that, as opposed to simply being required to allow inmates to possess.
Well, whose burden was it to propose accommodations?
Well, I think the government here met its burden to establish one, a compelling governmental interest. I mean, hot oil can be weaponized, and oil can be vaporized to permeate the air and mask the scent of controlled substances. It can be, you know, and bounce and soap is just not analogous. I mean, those, we're not comparing apples to apples, because, you know, if you've ever heated, for example, like basil infused olive oil, I mean, that permeates, you know, you can take a very small amount and it permeates the entire room. You can smell it. Whereas a bounce fabric softener, or some scented soap is not going to permeate the air the way that a heated oil does, because the oil vaporizes, right? So oil is unique, and the unscented oil doesn't present that concern because it's unscented. So that's, I think, one instance where the judge just failed to afford appropriate deference to prison officials in terms of their ability to detect controlled substances. And she didn't really deal with that. She raised as an issue this idea of, you know, the prisoners are allowed to use balance and unscented oil and things like that. And I don't think it essentially addressed the concern about scented oil permeating the air. And,
well, if a prison official smells scented oil throughout the day, isn't that a sign that something is amiss?
I think it would be a sign that something was amiss, but I don't know necessarily that we should put the prison officials in the position of having to deal with the scented oil as a preliminary matter before they address the question of whether there's illegal substances in the cell. And I think scented oil can be used as an irritant. It can be used to irritate other inmates or other prisoners.
Well, so that's the same with unscented oil, I'm assuming.
Well, I think unscented oil can be heated, right? And it could be thrown on it. You know, it could be wet, right, same way as a, although oils have different chemical properties, and some have a much higher flash point. So, I mean, if you have a high viscosity, high flash point oil, that's a much more effective weapon than one with a lower flash point, right? And those issues weren't discussed really from either side. I mean, we just kind of threw out this idea that baby oil is prevalent and it can be used as a weapon, and neither side really explored that. But I think initially, The government met its burden to show, one, that there was a compelling governmental interest, and two, that it was the least restrictive means. At least the least restrictive means is keeping the oil out of the cell. Now that's not to say that maybe the chapel shouldn't be opened, you know, 3, 4, 5 times a week. I don't know, and that's something that I think should have been explored, and the party should have had an opportunity to address that, and they didn't, because again, the ground rules for the trial just weren't very clear.
Can I ask just one? I'm sorry, just one other question.
Sure, go ahead.
Did the prison put any evidence in the record to show that scented baby oil was used to mask the smell of contraband or drugs?
I don't think they allow scented baby oil, right? It's unscented. They only allow unscented baby oil. That was my impression of the transcript. Having read the transcript, there was no testimony, as far as I recall, about scented baby oil. You know, the prison officials allow the use of unscented baby oil.
So, I mean, it is speculation then that prisoners could use scented baby oil to mask contraband then.
It is. It's speculation.
Okay. Yes. All right. If there are no additional questions, Mr. Zanino, you are over time, and we'll turn to Mr. Williams.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court, Ed Williams, for the Howard University School of Law Civil Rights Clinic, for plaintiff appellee Lausteveion Johnson. Our LUPA forbids the Nevada Department of Corrections from hindering Mr. Johnson's religious practice of using scented oils for his daily prayers, unless doing so is the least restrictive means of accomplishing some compelling government interest. The district court correctly found that the Department of Corrections failed to demonstrate that refusing to permit Mr. Johnson a half ounce of scented prayer oil in his cell is the least restrictive means of accomplishing any compelling government interest. There is no question that daily prayer with scented oil is a religious exercise within the meaning of our LUPA. The statute itself does not require that the religious exercise or practice at issue be central to the particular religion, only that it be a religious exercise that is sincerely held and believed by the person who was incarcerated. The Supreme Court in 2015 in Holt goes extensively into the discussion of what exactly a religious exercise is, and there defines a religious exercise narrowly as a person who is incarcerated's right or their ability to practice their faith by having a half inch beard. This was Holt, and I'm thinking about my friend on the other side's a hypothetical, Holt does not allow a broad definition of the religious exercise. It was not just some beard, some mustache, some goatee. In Holt, the way the Supreme Court defined the religious exercise was based on the request and the sincerely held belief of the person who was incarcerated. There, it was a request for a half inch beard. Here, it is a request for the daily exercise of praying with scented oils. The district court found as a factual matter, subject to clear error review, that Mr. Johnson's belief in the daily use of scented oil for prayer is a sincerely held religion. Ms. Baker, in her briefing before this court, I'm looking at her opening brief at page 23, conceded that she does not challenge any factual matters that were found by the district court, which presumptively would include that one. That religious exercise is substantially burdened because the Nevada Department of Corrections, specifically its policy, Administrative Regulation 810.2, does not permit personal possession of any amount of scented oil for prayer purposes. I heard my friend on the other side suggest both that 18.2 is the reason that Mr. Johnson does not have access to the scented oil, but also that it is not. If you look at Administrative Regulation 810.2, there is a box for Islamic or Muslim practicing faith. It has in the far right column, or in the left, the far right two columns, one that says allowable personal items, and then one for allowable group items. In the box for allowable personal items are items like a prayer mat. But what is not included in that box is scented oil for prayer. That is the problem with the regulation. That regulation spans the entire Department of Corrections across Nevada, which is why it does not matter that a particular facility might have a particular way of enforcing the policy. The policy itself, 810.2's exclusion of scented prayer oil from the personal possession box, is what is preventing, according to the briefing, but also according to the regulation, Mr. Johnson from exercising his religious faith.
Well, isn't opposing counsel correct, though, if prisoners were allowed access to a chaplain five times a day, then there'd be no violation here?
That's correct, Your Honor. However, below, the Nevada Department of Corrections specifically argued that that was not a feasible or permissible exercise. And the district court analyzed and actually agreed with the Nevada Department of Corrections on that point, which is why it was one of the alternatives that was rejected by the district court for the injunction.
Mr. Williams, when that analysis was undertaken, was it done separately for each facility? My assumption, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is that when Mr. Johnson testified, he was housed at Lovelock, and he was talking about his inability to access the prayer oils while at Lovelock. But I didn't see any testimony about how practices at other facilities might impede his ability to have prayer oils. So did he provide that testimony, or was there any discussion about what happens in different facilities other than the one at which he was housed at the time of trial, which appears to be Lovelock?
Sure, Your Honor. The first answer is no. There was not testimony as to the operations at other facilities other than the one he was housed at. But the second and more important answer is that it was not Mr. Johnson's burden to demonstrate. So the RLUIPA as a statutory matter provides that once a person who is incarcerated demonstrates a substantial burden on their religious exercise, all other burdens of persuasion fall to the institution, in this case, to the state of Nevada and its Department of Corrections. It was the Nevada Department of Corrections' statutory obligation to put in the record that a future transfer, and in fact, Your Honor, you may recall from some of the briefing that Mr. Johnson actually had been transferred multiple times during the pendency of the case. So they certainly could not have suggested or argued that they didn't know he might be transferred again in the future. He had already been transferred, I believe, three times since the case was initially raised. So if the Nevada Department of Corrections intended to defend its policy 810.2, which it knows is a policy that applies to the entire Department of Corrections and all of its facilities, if it intended to defend it on a facility by facility basis, it would have needed to put the evidence in the record. So Your Honor, the more important or salient point I think we want to make there is that it was simply not Mr. Johnson's burden to make that proof of evidence. It was on the Department of Corrections to do so, and they did not do so. Once a plaintiff demonstrates that his religious exercise has been substantially burdened, the burden shifts. And the Nevada Department of Corrections did place into the record several governmental interests, which the district court credited as compelling. The district court found that while bartering may be an issue, that the Nevada Department of Corrections admitted that other valuable items also may lead to bartering, but are yet available. The Nevada Department of Corrections discussed contraband or the potential masking of contraband. The district court analyzed that particular issue and found that no evidence was presented on the amount needed to mask contraband. While my friend on the other side today speculates about the potential vaporizing of oil, there was no factual evidence in the record to support that particular claim. And again, it was the state's burden to place that evidence in the record for adjudication. The district court, because there was no evidence from the state on the amount of oil needed to mask contraband, the district court credited the only testimony in the record with respect to this issue, which was Mr. Johnson's. And Mr. Johnson's, his testimony was that one would need to, quote, drench his cell in order to mask contraband. Now, of course, Mr. Johnson is himself not a chemist or someone able to make a particular analysis of how much oil may be needed. But again, it was the only evidence in the record, and the state did not meet its burden. As respect to inmate and staff health, another issue or compelling government interest or interest raised by the government about tattooing, the district court found that Associate Warden Nash, again, the government's own witness, testified that the oils are clear and there is no evidence of use for tattooing. And then finally, on the point of judicious use of resources, the district court rejected two of the alternatives that it found would put a real strain on Nevada Department of Corrections resources. One, the district court rejected Johnson's claim to allow him to go to the chaplain five times a day, as Judge Bumate has suggested, to get the oil. And the district court also rejected Mr. Johnson's alternative of having the correctional officers administer the scented oil. And instead, the district court adopted what it believed to be the only permissible or possible alternative presented by Mr. Johnson, which is to have a half ounce of scented oil in his cell to be administered on a weekly basis by the chaplain. Finally, as to the correctional officers using their sense of smell to identify contraband, the district court specifically addressed this issue as well and found that if correctional officers can familiarize themselves with the smell of other scented products, that they can familiarize themselves with the smell of scented oil as well and determine how to distinguish it from contraband. In short, Your Honors, the district court considered each and every compelling government interest raised by the Nevada Department of Corrections and determined that none of them compelled barring Mr. Johnson from having a half ounce of scented oil for daily prayer use to be administered by the chaplain. Finally, Your Honor, I want to use the remaining minutes to just address the injunction issue. I believe Judge Beatty, you brought this up in question with opposing counsel. Appellant claims in their briefing that it is the NDOC or Nevada Department of Corrections policy, again, 810.2, that bars Johnson from access to the sensitive oil. We accept that position. And accepting that position, it is the director of the Nevada Department of Corrections that is responsible for the Nevada Department of Corrections policy. And Johnson, Mr. Johnson did bring suit against that person. At the time, that person was Mr. James Cox, who was sued in his official capacity. He's named in the complaint. And Mr. James Cox, again, in his official capacity, is also named in the injunction issued by the district court. So again, it is a policy issue, a policy level issue by the Nevada Department of Corrections. It is the policy that Mr. Johnson challenged, and it is the policy that the district court enjoined. And therefore, it is immaterial that Mr. Johnson has been transferred to multiple facilities or maybe transferred to future facilities at the Nevada Department of Corrections, because it is the policy at issue that is preventing him from having access to the sensitive oil. Of course, Mr. James Cox is no longer the director of Department of Corrections. I believe that now that person is Mr. Charles Daniels. Again, that is, of course, is immaterial because he was sued in his official capacity. And so his successor in interest also bears the burden of ensuring lawful access to religious rights. So for that reason, there's no mootness issue, which we believe was raised by opposing counsel. Your Honors, for that reason, we believe that the injunction was proper, that the district court conducted a thorough bench trial, and that the Nevada Department of Corrections cannot now, on appeal for the first time, attempt to present new evidence or otherwise provide hypothetical evidence that it had the burden, again, the statutory burden under RLUIPA, to provide in the record at the time of trial. For those reasons, we ask that this court affirm the district court and permit the injunction to become final. If there are no other questions, Your Honor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Williams. Right. Mr. Zanino, you wanted to reserve 3 minutes. You actually went about 2.5, close to 3 minutes over, but I will nonetheless give you a minute for rebuttal.
Thank you, Judge. Just real quickly on the question of mootness, you know, the briefs raised the question of mootness in two contexts, one with regard to the transfer of between prisons. And I don't think that actually presents a question of mootness. I think it just presents a question of prejudice, you know, whether the rules of the trial were sufficiently clear that the parties were able to present relevant, focused evidence. But I think that the mootness goes to the question of the regulation itself. And when this complaint was filed, I would submit that the challenge to the facial validity of that regulation was valid, and to their credit, Nevada prison officials amended that regulation to allow for the use of scented oil in a chapel setting or in a communal setting. Maintain that in fact mooted any kind of facial challenge to the regulation itself. But the judge just...
Counsel, can you respond to Mr. Williams' point that it was the Nevada's burden to show that there was other accommodations, such as allowing him the client access to the chaplain 5 times a day?
Well, I think that was the problem with the trial is the evidence kind of got far afield because the rules of the trial weren't clear. So it wasn't clear what was being addressed. The parties, you know, had the judge focused the inquiry on the as applied challenge, I think it would have given the state the opportunity to provide detailed evidence on that question. But instead, they were kind of going back, well, is this a facial challenge? Is it an as applied challenge? And ultimately, I think,
counsel, don't you have the responsibility to present your case? I mean, is the district judge supposed to shape the issues for the parties and then tell you what to present? I'm not really sure what you're trying to ask us to do, because you haven't alleged any error, sort of procedural error on the part of the district court. I mean, you mentioned a few times you thought there were no ground rules, or the ground rules weren't very clear, but I don't know how that's an appealable issue or one that you've presented to us.
Well, Your Honor, the question of mootness raises a jurisdictional question. I mean, like it or not, you know, mootness is a jurisdictional issue.
But what does that have to do with your comments about how you didn't know what the ground rules were at the trial and the plaintiff had a lot of claims and it wasn't focused? I mean, I just don't understand how any of that advances your argument.
Well, if the judge had dealt separately with the question of mootness as to the regulation itself or as to a facial challenge to the regulation, it would have focused the inquiry, right, at trial. But there was no separate ruling on the question of mootness. It was just rolled in to the trial and the issues got conflated at trial. So I think there was an anomaly, a procedural error in the sense that the judge did not address the amendment that clearly mooted any kind of facial challenge to the regulation itself. So I think that's how kind of things went astray in this case. And ultimately, the remedy that was fashioned or crafted strikes down effectively what was a facially valid regulation, but, you know, without kind of exploring these alternatives. And
all right. Thank you. I think we understand your argument. Thank you both for your arguments this morning. And this case will be taken under submission.
Thank you.